early access of legal assistance in the event of arrest. Arrest, essentially, is an anathema to liberty. Ordinarily, an individual is free. It's only when the conflict of state need to maintain law and order or the state necessity to investigate a crime requires deprivation of liberty, then and only then an individual can be subjected to an arrest and detention. Now, therefore, the concept of arrest is a conflict between an individual's right to freedom and the state's need to curb it for the purpose of investigating a crime or maintaining law and order. So these twin aspects, one of the state necessity for maintaining law and order and investigating a crime, which is of paramount importance to maintain orderliness in society and to investigate crime and punish wrongdoers. And on the other hand, the primary and the most cherished rights of an individual, not only a fundamental right, a basic human right, that of liberty, come in straight and direct conflict. Now, when these two rights come in conflict, one of the state and another of the individual, the necessity of legal assistance to the individual becomes paramount because it is a curb on the executive action on the police. Legal assistance, if properly given, can immediately prevent executive excesses. Executive excesses take place from the time of illegal arrest, unnecessary arrest, and detention without a lawful arrest. So these are areas which an average citizen, particularly in a country like India where education or level of literacy is measured by your ability to sign on a paper and not on proper and effective education and understanding of rights, is extremely important that the executive power, which is vested by statutes, particularly the codes of criminal procedure and other laws, providing the law enforcing agencies their right to deprive liberty of individuals, including foreigners, citizens, and everyone, in given situations, are being lawfully exercised or not. Now, whether they are lawfully exercised or not is not within the realm of ordinary understanding of an individual. Because a law enforcing officer, with the very fact that he is having the authority to exercise certain statutory powers, may decide to exercise powers. If I can quote from a line from a Supreme Court decision, Joginder Kumar, delivered in 1994, it is one thing to have the power of arrest, it is entirely different to exercise the same. So there may be powers of arrest vested in a police officer, but whether it was lawful to exercise such power at a particular time, in a particular manner or in a particular given fact situation, for an ordinary citizen, it is impossible to assess and react. So he would immediately need the assistance of a lawyer. He would immediately need the assistance of a lawyer to advise him, suggest him, and to give him legal redress. Now the second necessity of legal redress or access to counsel in events of arrest is that arrest is a deprivation of personal liberty under Article 21. Constitution of India, Part 3, provides for certain fundamental rights. And perhaps the most fundamental of those fundamental rights is provided in Article 21 of the Constitution. It says no one shall be deprived of life or personal liberty except by procedure established by law. The concept of procedure established by law would be akin to the concept of due process of law, has been through the process of judicial interpretations brought into by the Supreme Court into the Indian Constitution. So, if there are laws which provide for arrest but do not provide for adequate and just remedies in respect of such arrest, such laws would be rendered ultra vires, Article 21, being arbitrary, unreasonable, unjust, oppressive, and therefore violative of that provision of law, fundamental right. Now, since arrest is a deprivation of Article 21, to understand and to address a court or the executive that this arrest in a particular fact situation, whether it is in accordance with procedure established by law, can only be done by a lawyer and not a layman. That is why, again, access to legal redress or access to counsel becomes so much important in the events of an interface between a law enforcing agency exercising its powers of arrest upon an ordinary citizen who is deprived accordingly. Third, defense counsel has to implement existing rights because of lack of education, legal or otherwise, among the people. I have already addressed this with regard to the first point when curb on executive excesses. India is a country where literacy is measured by the ability of a person ascribing his own signature on a white paper. That literacy is perhaps not sufficient for a person to understand whether his arrest is legal, whether his arrest is necessary, whether his arrest is, according to court Article 21, procedure established by law. This is why access to legal counsel becomes all the more necessary. This may be an added feature which may not be so sensitive, because I would rather say, apart from the fact that a person has a legal counsel, just as in Miranda rights, it is the paramount duty of a law enforcing agency when he effects his arrest to inform the citizen, sir, madam, I am putting you under restraint, I am putting you under arrest, you have the right of consulting a lawyer of your own choice. This is the first breach which takes place in the event of an arrest. Even if you see the arrest memos which have come into being in every state after the judgment of T.K. Basu delivered by the Supreme Court enumerating the provisions, which I would rather say was a reiteration of the constitutional provisions which were already there and a minor dilations therefrom. But none of the arrest memos says, I can at least from my experience in the eastern states, including other states also, but in, definitely in the eastern states, none of the arrest memos says that the right to access to legal counsel has been informed to the arrestee. I can understand what is going on through all the minds of lawyers. Now, this arrest memo is a hogwash. This arrest memo is only papers. They are signed before he is challenged or remanded to the court. Fine. Still then, I am asking myself and my friends here, how many of us have criticized an arrest memo on this issue? That look here, this is an arrest memo which says this man was arrested here, he was informed that he has been arrested, his family members were sought to be informed but he declined to give the address of his family members, which are the general explanations given for failure to information or intimation. But where is that line in that arrest memo that he has right to access to a lawyer? And that is the foundation of all rights relating to arrest and detention as declared by the US Supreme Court in Miranda and adopted by the Supreme Court in Balbir Singh, Baldev Singh, and a host of decisions relating to arrest, including D.K. Basu, including Joginder Kumar, D.K. Basu. The first thing I would address is that the arrest memo must incorporate that Article 22, Clause 1, information to the arrestee that he has a right to choose his lawyer of his own choice. Let me digress here. In India, we have a high-profile suspect put on trial, Kasab, in a 26/11 terrorist attack in Mumbai. When did the court, I question myself, seek an assistance under 303 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which provides for a state-funded defense? When was it given? It was given when the police report was filed. The law says the day he was arrested and produced before the court, did he have a lawyer? Did the magistrate ask him, sir, do you want to be represented by a lawyer? Day in, day out, I presume, I did not have the privilege of going through his records, but I'm sure he was remanded on various dates before court. But where was this duty, which is a fundamental right of an individual, to have access to a lawyer of his own choice, being facilitated by A, the law enforcing agencies, then B, the judiciary? This is more observed in the breach. The right to counsel of his own choice is considered more in the nature of a dilatory defense tactic to delay trials, and it is construed with the least and perhaps great skepticism that these rights are only to be, as Sanjeeva rightly pointed out, kept in the law books. In the actual functioning, it happens. Ajay was telling me that the violations take place more in the states, not at the center, at Delhi. I can go to the courts at Kakkaduma, go to the courts of Tees Hazari, go to the courts in other places around Haryana and Western UP. See how many of the accused persons are represented by lawyers during remand. 1979, Husainara Khatun, Supreme Court said that it is from the day of first production he has a right to be represented by a lawyer of his own choice. This is the extent of judicial consciousness to the issue of Article 22 Clause 1. This is why I say lack of education. I have restricted it to the people. Well, the peoples of India include the lawyers and also persons who are banning other higher and mightier posts. So magistrate will at least have 20 to 30 thanas, police stations. Each police station on a day will remand at least 10 accused persons. So 250 persons he has to represent on a day. Now, well, even if Nani Palkiwala was asked to do so, I don't know how far you would have been doing justice to the clients. Then the fourth thing which I would address as a remedial measures, which are lawyers, if they are representing accused persons at the preliminary stages of arrest and detention, should most definitely do. Necessity of documenting evidence in early stages of arrest and detention in cases of breaches of procedure. Breaches of procedure are actually, in fact, and more often than not, there is a presumption of regularity of state action. So until and unless the breaches are immediately brought to the notice of the superior police authorities or the court, by way of filing bail applications or petitions or affidavits, in a latter situation of trial or illegal arrest or a writ petition for compensation for such illegal arrest, I will show how the Supreme Court has reacted and said, in the lack of such evidence which is independent and documentary in nature, we are unable to accept the versions of alleged breaches. Now, this is an area where I will not dwell much. I will just go through the provisions which provide, which all of us know. We are here not to learn law. All of us know the law. The question is how much of this law is actually in operation. I would rather say this is the potentiality of the law. And let's say the kinetic operation of the law. Now, kindly see Article 22 Clause 1, which I was addressing you. Arrestee needs to be informed of grounds of arrest, right of counsel of his own choice. Section 50 of the Code of Criminal Procedure again reproduces the same thing. Person to be informed of the grounds of his arrest, and right to bail. There's a new amendment of this Code of Criminal Procedure, Section 50, Capital A. This is actually incorporating some of the clauses of D.K. Basu, now becoming statutory provisions, mandatory for making any for any person making arrest to inform friend and relative as nominated by the arrestee of such arrest and place of custody. This is the D.K. Basu clause which has been incorporated now into the law. 56, 57 and 76 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which says that they must be produced before the nearest magistrate within 24 hours, which is also the provision under Article 22 of the Constitution of India. Then comes the right to legal representation, Section 303 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, Section 304 of the Criminal Procedure. Here, Hussainara Khatun is a very important decision which says from the date of arrest, the person becomes an accused for these purposes, having legal redress and a right to legal counsel. Section 54 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which says right to be examined by a medical practitioner, in evidence on such examination would disprove the commission of offence. Article 20 clause 3 and section 161. 20 clause 3 is right against self-incrimination and 161 provides that any statement before a police is not admissible as evidence. Now this is very important because there are certain law enforcing agencies before whom, let's say a customs officer, an excise officer, a narcotic officer under the NDPS Act, where a statement made before these officers are admissible and the bar under section 161 do not operate. So in such cases, any lawyer who is representing an accused, who is accused of such crime and is being investigated into by an officer before whom a statement is admissible in law, must definitely interview the accused of any circumstances which may vitiate such purported confession, namely coercion, undue influence, or any other like nature. Because if such a situation arises, then again, let me go back to the necessities one, fourth clause, duty to documentary evidence with regard to alleged breaches. Because if there is a purported confession, it must be retracted at its earliest, and secondly, the retraction must reflect the reasons for the person being compelled to make such a purported confession. Now, if such retraction does not take place at its earliest production, subsequent retraction becomes suspect. So, a lawyer representing an accused must interview the accused, interrogate the accused as to whether he has been made to sign blank documents, whether he has been compelled to make a confession, and if such compulsions are in the nature which renders the confession invalid or vitiated in law, documentize such fact in his bail application or an independent application of retraction before the magistrate. If not produced before the magistrate, then definitely before the superior police officer or the Human Rights Commission, if any is constituted under the Protection of Human Rights Act. This is very important. Then are the laws which have been effect of law under Article 141 of the Constitution through judgments of the Supreme Court. One is Joginder Singh versus State of UP, which guidelines I have now incorporated into Section 50, Capital A. Then D.K. Basu, it says that there should be identification of the arresting officer, memo of arrest should be prepared, arrestee should have a friend or relative to whom information should be given about the time and place where he is detained after arrest, entry in a diary at a place of detention regarding particulars of arrest, arrestee on request can be examined of injuries and inspection memo then made should be signed by him and PO and copy provided to him. This is something which is observed mostly in the breach. No physical examination takes place. Arrestee to be examined by a trained doctor every 48 hours of his detention of police custody. That also I've hardly found any. Arrestee may be permitted to meet his lawyer during interrogations. A police control room to be provided in all districts, state headquarters, where the particulars of arrest to be displayed prominently within 12 hours. Now, the more important things. These are the provisions which have been engrafted in that law, in that judgment. Now, what would happen if these are breached? failure of compliance a departmental action. Now, departmental action hardly takes place. You give a report to the superior officer, it remains in the dockets. B, contempt of court initiated in any high court having territorial jurisdiction where the alleged breach takes place. Now, in all these contempt cases, and particularly one case I would point out before the Supreme Court where Article 32 was taken out, how the Supreme Court dealt with such a case or violation. We would find that lack of documentary material and lack of independent corroborative material is the biggest stumbling block to prove events of deviation and violation of the wholesome provisions or the laws declared in D.K. Basu's judgment. Now, what are the effects of these breaches? Let us say I am interrogated or arrested by someone who does not have an emblem saying he is an SI of police. Does it exonerate me from the trial? Does it entitle me for bail or release? The Supreme Court says no. That when a remand application is placed before the magistrate would see whether the materials collected is sufficient to detain the man, and on the basis of such remand, he would consider the release, not on the violation of the clauses relating to arrest. This is where most of the defense lawyers feel, what is the use of making such a brouhaha over arrest? My client neither gets bail, nor does he get an exoneration from the charge. So why create such a noise? The reason for creating noise is not only an exoneration from trial or detention, but the reason for creating a noise with regard to illegal arrest is, illegal arrest is the starting point for creation of illegal evidence. Evidence is created by the very factum of arrest. Now, if a man who is alleged to be a decoy is arrested from his home, but in the arrest memo it is shown that he is arrested from the place of occurrence, that itself is an incriminating fact. So, it may by itself not exonerate an accused, but it would be one of the strong defenses of the accused in the course of trial. This must be borne in mind whenever an accused or his family approaches any one of us for representing an arrestee for the first time when he is produced in court or in subsequent stages of remand. Then the next point, irregularity becomes relevant when questions of encounter deaths come. Section 46 subsection 3 is a very dangerous provision in the Code of Criminal Procedure in India, which says that any police officer who finds that a suspect who is suspected of commission of offense which is punishable with death or life imprisonment is running away or trying to escape, he can cause death. And such death is not punishable in law, equatable with the right to private defense under section 96 to 101 of the Indian Penal Code. So such paramount, and mind you, not even subject to any subsequent mandatory judicial inquiries. So any, because 176 of the Code of Criminal Procedure has been amended in 2005, that custodial death must be followed up with a judicial magistrate inquiry, but not an encounter death under 46.3. So, a police officer under 46 subsection 3 is the prosecutor, judge and executor. He prosecutes you for running away. He prosecutes you because you are running away. You are a suspect of a crime which is punishable with death or life imprisonment. He takes his decision that you are running away in such manner that you can only be liquidated in order to stop you from doing so. So, he judges it and then he executes it by killing. And there is no judicial review under the law with regard to 46 subsection. It is a more dangerous provision of law than custodial deaths, encounter deaths. Andhra Pradesh full bench, delivered a judgment saying that mandatory judicial inquiry is necessary, Supreme Court in the SIP has granted an order of stay on that judgment. So it is sub judice. But statute as it stands today does not provide for any inquiry apart from a departmental inquiry in respect of every police firing which is under the relevant local police rules. Apart from such, there is no judicial inquiry, executive inquiry with regard to encounter deaths. So illegal arrest is very important in respect to trials of encounter deaths where the police officer is an accused. If the arrest is somehow illegal, then his exercise of powers under 46 subsection 3 becomes clearly illegal without authority. Third issue is also the same. If arrest is illegal, the arrestee can exercise his rights under 96 to 106 of the Indian Penal Code. He will not be charged under 332, 333 of the Code of Indian Penal Code saying that he is obstructing a public servant with discharge of official duty, because that discharge of official duty itself was illegal. That is where D.K. Basu's judgments become very, very important. They are actually defenses. And yes, they are actually defenses. These illegal arrests or illegal actions at the time of arrest become very important defenses in respect of trials of individuals under 332, 333 of the Indian Penal Code. Persons affecting, now, what are the breaches available? Persons who is effecting illegal arrest may be tried and punished under 342 to 344 of the Indian Penal Code with regard to wrongful restraint and wrongful detentions. Very minor penalties. Tort of false imprisonment and damages, a suit ordinarily in India will have a longevity of 20 years. The only thing which may be of some practical consequence was the D.K. Basu's prescription of a contempt application or a writ in the nature of prerogative writ under Article 32 or 226 seeking remedies of damages in the public law realm, which started off from Rudolf Shah and in Nilabati Behera's case in 93, the Supreme Court at the occasion of dealing elaborately saying that whenever there is a breach of fundamental right, particularly that of liberty in the form of custodial death or in the form of other custodial violences, remedy of compensation is a valid remedy which the courts can fashion out in public law realm. This remedy, in addition to the civil law remedy in private law by way of a tortious claim of false arrest and imprisonment. Then the other provisions of 330, 331 of the Indian Penal Code, punishment for those who inflict injury or grievous hurt to extort confessions or information with regard to commission of an offence. 220 of the Indian Penal Code, punishment of an officer or an authority who keeps a person in confinement with malicious motive. Section 7 of the Police Act 1861 provides for dismissal, suspension, reduction in rank, in grant, rank or grant of any police officer of subordinate rank whom the higher officials think is negligent in discharge of his duties. That is departmental action. Now, the inadequacies which operate in the field, particularly in the implementation of these laws, I say the theoretical remedies exist, but practice is different. In reality, courts show a penchant for rejecting claims of breach due to lack of sufficient evidence. Now, in this regard, I discussed two or three decisions of the Apex Court, because that would give a factual matrix as to how the law in operation had stumbled to give relief or remedy, although there was reasons to suspect that there was a breach. Raj Kumari was a C2 activist, a political trade union activist. He was camping with a people in front of a public institute. There was an illegal arrest, and the arrest did not get the support of any of the provisions of D.K. Basu's judgment. D.K. Basu's judgment, in fact, was observed in the breach. A Article 32 application was taken out before the Supreme Court. The police immediately came out with an affidavit saying that no, sirs, there was no violation. She was given all the possible respect required under law. And secondly, all due deference and compliance of law was made with regard to D.K. Basu's judgment. The Supreme Court said that in the view of these two conflicting affidavits, we are not in a position to decide for certain beyond reasonable doubt that Rajkumari in fact was subjected to a violation of the D.K. Basu principles at the time of arrest. Supreme Court in its words said that since there was no documented evidence of the purported breaches, nothing that is to say that the version of the police was untrue. Now, in these situations, as in the earlier part of my address I have said, the best way to remedy such situation is immediately in the event of a violation, let us document these facts before the superior police officers, not for the purpose that these officers will act, but for the purpose that a contemporaneously prepared documentary evidence will obviate all oral evidence to the contrary. The principles of assessment of evidence everywhere in the country gives credence to a documentary evidence created contemporaneously over oral versions. So, let us as lawyers, whenever approached by an arrestee or his family, where we find palpable breaches in respect of arrest, forthwith document them by way of complaints, representations to the superior authorities, Human Rights Commission, and to the nearest court where he is to be. The second of the judgments which I would like to consider and to address on is Subay Singh versus State of Haryana. Here a very interesting departure was made in 2006, and it's a three judgments decision of the Supreme Court. D.K. Basu says that in respect of all arrests, certain procedures have to be followed. Subay Singh was a man who is a history shooter. He had a number of cases in. And the violations that he complained, according to the Supreme Court, were not that grave enough. So, Supreme Court said, sort of, I would say, qualifying D.K. Basu here, that you can, in cases of minor breaches, go for compensation under ordinary. If you have to say compensation under public law, the breach must be, to quote the Supreme Court, it said that there has been a medical report or visible proof of torture, and violation of Article 21 should be of such magnitude as to shock the conscience of people. So, this is a subjective parameter which Subay Singh brings in. This parameter was not there in D.K. Basu. And I would like the human rights groups and activists to deal with this issue as to what will be shocking to the conscience of the court. Because these expressions, like rarest of rare cases which we have found while dealing with death penalty cases, receive very wide interpretations. For a particular court, a particular instance may not be rarest of rare which requires a death penalty. For a particular breach, it may not be really shocking the conscience of a particular court, but may shock the conscience of another court. A court in Bengal may not be shocked, but a court in Jammu Kashmir may be shocked. The question is, where do we draw a line with regard to shocking of conscience? And secondly, is another very interesting thing, that if you have to speak of custodial torture, you must give the proof of medical reports or verbal or visible proofs of torture. Or in other words, that torture must have visible marks on your body, which is not always the case. acts of physical torture may leave severe imprints on your mind which you cannot reprint on paper or your body, but may not create even a single scratch on your person. Now these are issues which require to be addressed. Law has to be developed. It is in the process of development. But as lawyers, we must be aware of it. So, since such a law as it exists and binds us, we must create evidence to show that torture was of such nature that it did not create a visible mark, but had an indelible mark on the psyche of the arrestee, which may shock the conscience of people. So we have to address so that we take into consideration the law. Because as defense lawyers, we first must know what the prosecutor may cite against you. Like a game of chess, you must know what is his other side's move, so that you can counteract it even before your prosecutor can present the charge. Then look here, this is a situation where Supreme will not apply, because the nature of torture I complain of is a torture which may not have visible marks, but is of such nature which will shock the conscience of any prudent man. This is how we deal with a case as Supreme said. Then comes another decision wherein Masooda Parveen, the mother of a suspected terrorist, is gunned down in Punjab, had taken out a writ petition for compensation. And there again, it was, although this principle of law is said, that the court said that in cases where parties have decidedly unequal power and resources, it must tilt towards the hapless victim. However, it still rejected the petition, alleging custodial torture resulting in death due to lack of documented evidence. So each and every decision where we find that the courts, after giving a clarion call to eradicate custodial violence, is failing to give the compensation to the victim of such alleged violence, is because violence or breaches are unable to be established or proved because of lack of contemporaneous evidence. So, the creation of contemporaneous evidence becomes very, very important if we want that the clauses of D.K. Basu and other provisions relating to custodial torture to be countenanced as serious causes of action resulting in relief and remedy to the victims. Finally, in S.A. Ghafoor v. Dabol, the Supreme Court in fact reiterated what the 113th Law Commissioner said, that in cases of custodial violence, it would be incumbent on the custodian of the body of the arrestee to establish that he did not perpetrate the violence. Or in other words, the onus would be put on the person who has detained the individual, because he has special knowledge as to the circumstances which resulted in the injuries or the death of the arrested person. This is a principle of law which we should bear in mind even at the preliminary stages of arrest, and in the event a custodial death of an arrested person takes place, we can apply this law of evidence which was proposed by the Law Commission and accepted by the Supreme Court to ask the magistrate to immediately initiate an investigation against the person in whose custody the victim had suffered such injuries. Because until and unless the person who was the custodian of the body of the victim is unable to give reasonable explanation thereto, there will be a presumption that he was the perpetrator of such violence. The Code of Criminal Procedure in 2009 has made certain changes in the matter of arrest. They have now amended Article 41 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. Now, I should bring it to the notice of this seminar that these provisions, however, have not been given effect. They have been incorporated, the assent has been given by the President, but the date on which it is to be brought into force have not been notified by the central government. But nonetheless, since they have been provided, I have added them to my address. The distinction has been made that offences above 7 years and offences below 7 years. Offences below 7 years, the propensity to arrest has been sought to be curbed by saying just because there is reasonable suspicion of arrest, you will not arrest the person. You must have reasonable belief of arrest. So the level of satisfaction of the police officer has been enhanced from one of reasonable suspicion to belief. And secondly, the reason for his arrest has to be incorporated in the arrest memo. These are two primary changes which have been brought in between offences below 7 years and offences above 7 years. And with regard to another aspect of arrest, the amendment has incorporated 41A to 41D, where the police officer, instead of arresting an individual, has the right to give a notice to appear. And upon such notice to appear, the person will not be arrested and he would be subjected to interrogation at the police station as and when the police officer will call him to or summon him to such police station. There is a paradox in this. The paradox is, in the one hand, again, the police officer is the issuing authority which gives the person immunity from arrest. And on the other, he is the authority who would recall such a notice to appear and immediately arrest the individual. This would perhaps, when brought into force, require some judicial interpretation as to whether the police officer, when he decides to withdraw such immunity, can he immediately arrest or he should give some time to the individual so that in cases where the state law permits a pre-arrest bail to be applied, he may apply it. Otherwise, it would deny the pre-arrest bail privilege to an accused altogether by issuing a notice to appear, calling upon the unsuspecting, gullible suspect to come over to the police officer, and then the police officer, lo and behold, says, well, I am withdrawing that notice to appear and I am putting you in detention. This is a practical and pragmatic problem which we will have to address, but we will cross that bridge when we come there. Thank you. I have exchanged my experiences about arrest and detention with you. I know most of you, and I know that all of you are working in that frontier where persons are taken in detention and not produced before police officers or courts. Family members are not even aware as to what to do, and then after 6 days, 7 days, someone comes to any one of us and says that for 7 days this person is in jail or police custody, and it is being said that since his brother is an absconding dacoit, so he has been kept in such police custody till his brother comes. So I know you have more experiences about this than me. I would like, one by one, if you can come over and share your experiences with us. I think Sanjeeva and Ajay will also have a first-hand experience about what sort of an atmosphere in which all of us work.